it's a strange new world. We have to learn these new apps. We have to learn new ways to communicate. We can't meet in person until we figure this thing out. So, you know, we're all in it together.
That's the truth. We are. Yes.
All right. So, I'm going to record this thing because I want people to be able to hear from the people at the top and experts and like people that, you know, I mean, you were in the same crisis as I was and as many of our people were, you know, so I just want to give you a heads up in advance that I kind of want to record it so that people can look back at, you know, this time of history and look at all the pieces and hopefully learn lessons from this and, you know, just be better as a population.
Certainly. Certainly. Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. So let's just start from the initial report. So the way this whole thing went down basically was initially there was a, you know, a study out of the UK as they refer to the London Imperial model. And what that model predicted was up to 2.2 million Americans were going to die based on what they knew about this coronavirus coming out of Wuhan. If we took no lockdown procedures, 2.2 million Americans would die, which is, you know, an absolute, that's a catastrophe. That's one of the, that would be one of the worst events in American history. You know, I mean, 2.2 million people. Now, obviously, we attempted a lockdown procedure and, you know, we were supposed to be at the most optimistic levels able to contain this to about 250,000. Now, obviously, as this has unfolded, it's been nowhere near that reality. When the initial reports came out and you started hearing about what was coming our way, what were your first thoughts on it? Did you at all question the, you know, the validity of these reports? And just what were your first feelings on this situation?
Well, my first feelings, first of all, my background is I'm a veterinarian, so I've had a certain amount of training in epidemiology.
Sure.
We had a new virus coming our way that we had absolutely no immunity to, which would mean that every person in the United States could potentially be susceptible to it, to this. You had a lot of people saying, well, it's no different than the flu and not that many people die of the flu. But if you look at when influenza first came and we had no immunity, no vaccines, a lot of people died. And so I think some of the models were being based on that every single person was susceptible. Some that had a good immune system would probably survive, but those that didn't probably wouldn't. I thought the models were a little bit out of whack. I didn't think that we were going to see nearly as many people die, and we haven't seen as many people die, but one person dying is one person too many.
No, and I
think that all of our efforts have to be looking at the health and the safety of people, all of our efforts. And I think the lockdown efforts and all have gone a long, long way in preventing some of the deaths that were predicted. In fact, now I think the models have been lowered to more like 60,000, of which we've already had 40,000. Now that's a huge number.
And, no, absolutely. I mean,
it's small compared to 250,000, but it's still a large number. And so, and this virus will, regardless of the fact that we've flattened the plateau a little bit, for it, that it's still going to be around and people are still going to be susceptible. Right. And so I think that we have to still continue with the CDC guidelines. And I think that will help a lot, but until we really have a vaccine or until everybody's had it and those that recover have some immunity, right, assuming they have some immunity. Now, we've not dealt with this virus before. We would assume if it acts like other viruses.
Yeah, like even like the SARS outbreak, yeah.
Yes, that we will have the immunity, and we're assuming that there will be a vaccine developed within a 12 to 18 month period. Maybe it'll be quicker than that, but it still takes time to test it regardless of whether we have it or not. This will be with us, and this will change the way we do things for a long time.
So looking at those statements, I agree with you 100%. This was a novel disease. I mean, coronaviruses, as you know, have been around for decades. This was a new strain of a coronavirus that we knew nothing about, you know? So we obviously have to err on the side of caution. I agree with that 1,000%. But now with all infectious diseases, all, you know, any influenza, any coronavirus, any pneumonia, we always take into account asymptomatic cases. We take into account mild cases. We take into account moderate cases. Now, obviously, given we have to estimate those numbers, but if I was to report to you and I was to say, like the 2017 flu, for example, it hospitalized 959,000 in this country and over 61,000 people died. If I was to just give you those statistics, that's a 6% mortality rate, over 6%, which would cause mass panic. I mean, that's you know, mid-range of what they were reporting on Corona. Now, initially, I understand we may not have had those numbers. And as the model quickly changed its predictions, like the London Imperial model quickly started to notice, wait a second, we weren't taking into account asymptomatic, we weren't taking into account mild, we weren't taking into account moderate. We have to have these things to have a proper perspective on a virus. With that being said, the model starts drastically changing. Like the first revision was from millions to maybe a quarter million. And as you said now, you're correct. They revised it all the way down to 60,000. So there's studies taking place across the country currently that are coming. I don't know if you've been following, like in Santa Cruz, they did the antibody testing at Stanford University. So what they did is they looked at their county's numbers and they said, okay, our county is reporting this. We're going to blanket test people. Somewhat, you can't have already tested positive for COVID and you can't have symptoms. We want to look for only people that may have developed the antibodies. Stanford just published their information showing that they estimate that at least in their county, and they're, you know, obviously you can draw conclusions outward, they suspect we are 55 to 80 times inaccurate with the infection numbers. So we're, and on, before I go too far with this, on the White House briefing, Dr. Birx at one point, I watched every White House briefing, she gets in front and she says, hey, there's something that's going on here where we might be just looking at the tip of the iceberg. There might be this gigantic factor of asymptomatic cases, mild cases, non-hospitalizations, which we need for proper perspective. But nobody has taken any of these things into account. Everybody that's still perpetuating the same danger of this virus is not looking at all the information. And it's not just the one Stanford study. Boston, Massachusetts ran a study. They did the test. They did the test on the homeless. So in Massachusetts as well, they took 400 homeless. You can't have any symptoms. You can't have previously tested positive because homeless, as you know, they don't have good access to healthcare. They don't have good treatment available to them. They took 400 homeless, random society, we're going to blanket test. 147 tested positive without a single symptom. So when these things are coming out rapidly, why are we not, as you know, as a veterinarian and looking at infectious disease, you know, imagine if we reported influenza without the estimates for all the people that were infected that didn't have severe cases. I feel like it heavily distorts our feelings towards it. It heavily distorts the reality of the virus, which would then in turn distort policy and everything that we put into place.
I agree 100%. It's logical that with this virus that a lot of people have been exposed, those that had the immune system to get through, have gotten through it, and that would be a lot more people than that didn't. If you look at the percentages of those who have died, it's really scary on the older people, and myself being one of them.
No, of course.
I hear those numbers, and also geographic areas. If you took New York equation, New York City out of the equation,
it's almost half of the death count.
Yeah, United States would not even rank in the top 10 countries. However, you can't really take that out. In Detroit, I believe as of Saturday, either Friday or Saturday, 88% of the deaths and over 80% of the cases in Michigan were in the Tri-County area.
Yeah, Wayne County was the hardest hit.
Yes, by far. And the same thing with the nursing home, which is another thing, but most of the nursing homes being in that area, that's where a huge percentage of the nursing home deaths have been. And I think you have to look at that. I think you have to look at the crowding in there. You have to look at a lot of things that go into it. I'm glad to see a task force has been formed to look at that, because I think that we have to. When we're looking at the state of Michigan and we look at the numbers, and 88% are from one area. That
very small area.
It's pretty hard to think that we should deal with everybody and everything on the same basis. I think
that's what I was about to ask you in response to that, because, like, would a blanket strategy then for the entire country where millions are out of work? I mean, small businesses are collapsing in record numbers. We are doing incredible amount of damage, which, don't get me wrong, there are a few hot spots. There are a few difficulties. Like, I remember that the initial suggestion on why we were at a lockdown was flattening the curve, right? The goal was, we knew that, as you know, the virus is going to spread. Viral infections will spread. It's in every single country in the world. It was on aircraft carriers. It's going to spread. So what our goal was we're going to lock down to flatten the curve. That was the goal, so that our healthcare system would not be overrun, right? So the moment our healthcare system is not overrun and we are allowed to, you know, we produce record numbers of ventilators and masks and all these procedures, we followed all these orders. But now, as of a few days ago, Beaumont Hospital in Wayne, the hardest hit community in the state, closed down because they don't have enough COVID cases. They shut their doors. They're currently closed. And like you said, with New York getting pummeled, it's been proven already that over 3,700 of their deaths that are reported, they didn't even test for COVID. They just think it's a suspicion. It could be. How can we do that type of reporting in a pandemic? I mean, when charts reflect in history that heart disease and stroke and things that massacre human beings in this country all took a dip during Corona, there's going to be a lot of suspicion drawn from that. You know what I mean? So how can a blanket strategy that puts millions out of work, moves the largest sum of money in the history of the world in a bill because there's a few hard hit communities, that I don't see the validity of that. And I don't see, if it was about flattening the curve, the moment we had flattened that curve and we could handle the surges to not allow our healthy people and our children to be outside seems ridiculous, because that is how herd immunity works. Like, the kids are crushing this. I believe there's been one death at all in all of Michigan, even linked to someone below 18. And it was like someone with severe underlying conditions. You know, as you know, H1N1 killed 1,200 children. So our kids and our young adults are the protection for older people, for high risk population, because as we develop immunity, that's the miracle of herd immunity. That's how we make a barrier. So when you imply that logic across these cases, you see a very small amount of areas that are hit hard. The majority of the states don't even have 500 deaths. I don't even know if they have 250 deaths. So it's not this countrywide pandemic while we're putting millions out of work and making people's life work, you know, crumble to pieces, or people's life savings. But yet we're treating that way. I don't know how we justify that. You are obviously in the legislation at a much higher level than me. How do you explain that?
Well, first of all of the work that's been done by the government has been to protect safety and lives. And I think that the different states, the federal government had taken the tact of supply the states with what they need and let the states do it. And in our state, which is the one I can speak to probably better, we have the governor has the right to declare an emergency order.
Of course, quarantine laws.
And then once that is done, the governor can do executive orders. And the legislation that allows that to happen does not give the legislature any right to alter those, to alter or interfere with those things. So the object is to try to negotiate, try to work with the governor and try to come up with some solutions. And I think just recently we have come up with at least some guidelines to start opening up the economy again, because I agree with you, we've lost a lot of businesses that won't be back, family businesses that had been there for a long time.
And absolutely.
People are concerned. Last Wednesday, there was the demonstration in Lansing, yeah, which I think, unfortunately, there were people there in close proximity without masks, and that detracted from the whole reason up for the demonstration. There were thousands and thousands of cars and trucks in Lansing.
It was unbelievable.
Yeah, I tried to go up there just to support the business people that were there to demonstrate. I couldn't get within 2 miles of the Capitol an hour before. Honestly, I tried from several directions and you just couldn't get there. And I think that tells us something about what people, those were people that are losing their businesses, that have lost their jobs, that are concerned, deeply, deeply concerned about what's going to happen. And I think by having the we had to have a lockdown for a while, or we had to have, and I think we still should. People should, if they're going to be in a situation where they could either contact or spread the disease, they should be careful. They should wear masks. You should do the hygiene things. You should do the social distancing. But I think that we can start loosening things up, things like lawn service, I think, is one of the big
things. Sure, of course. Outside on the tractor.
Yes, yes. As a matter of fact, when you look at that, I know I have a lawn service, and I like to keep my place decent and all. So my lawn, the person that takes care of the lawn couldn't come out. So I could go to the hardware and buy a lawnmower and go through that transaction and all of that contact, then go to the gas station and get gas for it, where if my lawn service person had come out, I probably wouldn't have seen him.
Stay in your home.
Yeah. Yeah. So there are some, I think it's time to start loosening up. I think it's time to look at those things, but I think each and every person has a responsibility to think about how they're affecting the whole situation. I think if everyone sticks together, uses common sense as far as what can spread the disease and how it can be spread, I think that we can open things up, get the economy rolling again. We'll never ever come back, have the same type of lifestyle that we had before, and I think it's going to be a while before we can, they have the professional sports going, or even the amateur sports, to have that kind of crowding. It's unfortunate, but it's going to be hard to do for a while, simply because of the potential for
spread. So that's something that's incredibly important to address, because there's this idea, this new normal that's going to be presented. So, but here's the thing: by us continuing social distancing beyond the flattening the curve, you are literally slowing herd immunity and healthy people's ability to conquer this disease and protect our fragile population. If you restrict the movement of the healthy people, irrefutably, you are slowing herd immunity, which is a miracle in this world. I mean, our immune system in general is a miracle. We have a virus, we produce antigens, we develop immunity, and then that immunity lasts for a set period of time. Now, if we continue to restrict healthy people, We are slowing that process down, and we are going to keep this virus deadly much longer. If I am not out as a healthy human being, because I take care of myself, I'm always in shape. If I'm not out interacting and shaking someone's hands and developing an immune response, I then have a much longer period that you might be the one that has to work towards herd immunity, because the virus is going to stay around. It's not going to be crushed by our healthy people and our children and our things. And it's going to linger in society much longer. So herd immunity is like, it's the way that we've conquered almost every pandemic. Now, if millions were dropping dead, you can't take that approach. You have to slow it down, but they're not. I mean, our current predictions, as you said, are a seasonal flu level now. At this point, to suggest that healthy people shouldn't be out and interacting goes against everything we know about the immune response and herd immunity. It literally is a direct contradiction. Right? Because you want me to protect you because I develop the immunity, I help beat the disease. Now, don't get me wrong, if there are high risk people, or there's people, you know, that have major underlying conditions, maybe we keep them quarantined. Maybe we say, hey, you are at high risk, so you're going to go out at your own risk. If you choose not to wear a mask, that is your own risk. But we don't restrict the movement of our healthy populace, because that'll be our number one weapon in this fight against this disease.
Well, that is right. We need a lot more data. You referred to some of the data early on about only checking those people or that have the have signs of the virus, and then say this is what the percentage that have it is. Where
sure.
It, like the Stanford study showed that, wow, you know, 50 to 100 times.
Yeah, imagine if we were telling people a million people were infected and this many died and it was actually 60 million. All of us would be going, whoa,
yeah,
this virus ain't in anywhere near what it was.
Yes, and the flattening of the curve, I think we need a little more data before we can just open things up. But we should start opening things up. If you look at the TCF Center, we felt we weren't going to have enough beds. We had to open it. The suburban show place, my understanding is they're not even going to use it.
Yep. And they shut down Beaumont Wayne. How do you I mean, that's the hardest hit county in our state. They closed the hospital. How do we justify things like that? How could the curve be any more flat?
Well, I think that we definitely have to start bringing things back. We have to start bringing them back in a very thoughtful manner. We don't have the data on things. If you're looking now, some of the data that I look at is the hospital admissions when I can find it and the releases from the hospital. And lately the releases, all the hospitals are releasing more people than they're taking in. And
they've been releasing people at an alarming rate. I actually had a doctor friend at Beaumont said, hey, I probably shouldn't send you this document, but I'm going to. You always look into things, you always research. As of April 4th, they were sending that just Beaumont alone was sending thousands of positive patients back to their homes to quarantine with their families. They sent hundreds of pending tests. They had no idea whether they're going to test positive or not. Back into their homes, back into their communities. The idea of social distancing, in my opinion, if we actually implemented a procedure that made sense, it may be effective. If I go to McDonald's right now, there's a line in the drive-thru. If I go to the gas station, there's people everywhere. We're not wearing masks. If I go to the grocery store, half the people are complying, half the people are not. It's not even semi-close to the level that you would need for it to be impactful in the way that it needs to. You know what I mean? So you would either need to say, hey, for 6 weeks, we are going to strictly enforce this to a level that you haven't seen before, and you will be punished if you don't obey these guidelines because we're trying to save lives. At this point, to allow millions of people like me, I'm going to lose my business. I spent 10 years. I work with the juvenile court in the city. I help young kids. I've done motivational speaking. I spoke at graduate. I try to do everything I can to help you. I'm going to lose my entire business. Doesn't matter that I'm a healthy person. I take care of myself. I followed the guidelines. I quarantined. No matter how I've tried to present this information and show the fallacies in this argument, everyone just kind of saying, well, there's going to be a new normal and you're going to have to accept it. But with things like herd immunity being in real life, that's a real miracle thing. Healthy people are the barrier. Why are we going to destroy millions of lives without at least heavily investigating into this information? You know, and looking at it and saying, our processes at best are a weak attempt at the idea of keeping people apart, but they're not working. And even our hardest hit county, let's only look at Michigan. The main hospital is closed. We don't have this spike. And if you believe in social distancing, then you have to believe in that the moment we open back up, there would be another spike, right? If that did not take place, because if you're saying the reason this virus didn't run rampant, because you're subscribing to the theory that the virus is that deadly, then that means the moment we lift social distancing, our numbers should shoot up because then you have all these new infections. When in fact, South Dakota, Singapore, Sweden, all these places have put zero lockdown procedure. Sweden only 7 days ago implemented one rule. They said no groups larger than 50 close together. Other than that, that's it. South Dakota put no lockdown procedure. They have less than 10 deaths as of yesterday. So with that being said, all of this evidence is in front of us, but we're only looking at the initial response, which was, I understand, please take precaution. We don't know. This is novel. It could be deadly. But now you have countless studies saying antibody testing is showing this, and antibody testing is the reality of the situation, right? So it's social distancing. If you believe in that theory, the second we remove it, we should spike. We're not going to because it was widespread, because our social distancing was not strong enough. What do you think about that? I mean, because social distancing should say, when we get back, everybody that hasn't come in contact with it has a really good chance at it now.
Well, I think social distancing is helpful. However, in the examples that you gave, the social distancing is essentially natural. That they're not as crowded. They're not, and if you look at the statistics of where the diseases are coming from, it's where they can't social distance. There's no way to be apart. I guess I shouldn't use the term social distancing, but I would say common sense not being as crowded. And I know Sweden, I've looked at the figures and seen some of the things that are coming from there. I've been in Sweden before, and
yeah, same here.
It is the cleanest area I think I've ever seen.
I mean, they take care of themselves better than us, for sure.
Absolutely. You can be in downtown Stockholm and the streets are clean. You won't see it.
Same in Japan, and I've been all over. I've been shocked how well they take care of their homes.
Yes, and I think that has a lot to do with it. If you look, the virus isn't only spread from person to person. It's spread with different things carry it. You know,
surfaces and sure.
Yeah, the air can live in 3 hours within, what, a 6 feet, maybe a 13-foot thing. I've seen both figures. But
yeah, I saw that.
Things like copper, like a penny, it'll last for 4 hours. Cardboard is way up there at 24 hours. So, you know, and stainless steel and plastic, you're getting into the days. So you have a lot of things. The more crowded the people are and the more crowded they live, the more exposed they're going to be to all of those things.
Should we allow millions of Americans to lose their businesses in rural areas? Like someone like me, my community is not hit at all. We're not, and like I said, and this is still presuming that the virus is as dangerous as they're saying. If it turns out the asymptomatic cases were through the roof and maybe 2% of everything even required hospitalization and 3% of that were possible deaths, should me and millions of people be losing all of everything we've built for decades because in certain hard to contain areas there can be issues? How do we justify that?
Well, that's a good question. And that's why I really think we should start opening up on the low risk things. We don't have the data that we need. That's one thing I will agree with what, say, the governor has said is that.
Have you looked at all the new studies coming out? Have you looked at the Santa Cruz study, the Boston study, the aircraft area?
I've seen those. I'm talking about the data that we keep actually locally, or not locally, not Livingston County, but say statewide. I don't think that data is necessarily reflective of what this pandemic really is. I think
sure.
we're checking the very high percentage people that, as opposed to checking the general populations.
Absolutely. That's for sure what we need to do.
Thing we do. And when we get out state, the potential for exposure is so much less. We're going to have it. And flattening the curve, I think the flattening of the curve is probably what we had to do in the high density areas, the Detroit area, the Wayne County, Oakland County area. But as you can see by how the TCF center is hardly being used, Showplace won't be used. So to go with all of those things to see that there are many more people being released that were hospitalized and are coming in, I think that curve is being flattened. And when you get out state, you're down to 12% of the cases as opposed to the 88%.
And that's massive. That's a huge factor.
And if you look at some of the businesses that have been shut down, there probably is only remote chance that somebody would pick up the virus. No different than if they were going to pick up, say, a case of influenza that they didn't have the immunity for. So yeah, we definitely have to start opening up. There are businesses I know personally, quite a few people that are going to lose their business unless we can get things going again. And some of them that already have, regardless of what we do. That's tragic. We took the most dynamic economy in the world, probably that the world has ever known.
It was incredible.
And now it's kind of in shambles. I think it will come back. I have a hearty respect for the the resilience of the American people, but I do believe that we have to get that going again, and we can, and that there is no reason why some businesses can't get going.
So here's an area you have so much more knowledge on than me. I looked up the quarantine laws in this country, and I was speechless because I couldn't believe how much power resides in governors in the time of crisis. I mean, they are unbelievable, because I thought initially, there's no way a lot of these rules can be constitutional. I'm a huge person in the Bill of Rights. I study the Constitution endlessly. I believe in that American dream that we were taught when we were kids, that this is literally the land of the free, and if you have unalienable rights, I believe in those things, right? So I looked up the quarantine laws. You have governors. Let's Virginia, for example. They tried to pass legislation to be able to take people's weapons in a time of crisis, which is the Second Amendment. Now, as you know, being in legislation throughout human history, atrocities can be committed, not to say that there would be one here, when you have a disarmed population. Whether you are for or against the guns, the reason that was put into effect was because people have the right to be safe in there. You have the right to defend your family. We all know you don't have the right to kill someone, but you have the right to defend yourself. When you have legislation, you have governors trying to directly challenge the laws which all of this is built upon. How is that justified? And they can just say, I can do whatever I want because it's a quarantine. And how can we get, do you believe that needs to be revamped? The New Jersey governor on an interview said, he was interviewed by Tucker Carlson, and Tucker Carlson asked him a question. As you know, people have the right to peaceably assemble and practice their religion. You arrested and charged 12 people in a synagogue practicing social distancing for worship. Arrested and charged. How are you able to override the rules of the U.S. Constitution? He said, I wasn't thinking of the Bill of Rights when I put this order into place. So you have a Virginia governor trying to take away people's Second Amendment. You have one governor saying, I wasn't thinking of the Bill of Rights. And these quarantine laws, I'm not saying that they can't do them, because I looked them up. And in theory, the governor, basically whatever they deem reasonable, it's going to happen. And what if it's an unreasonable person? How do you feel about those responses in a pandemic?
I think that the governor, or say the president, somebody has to have the power to act quickly. I think this points out very, very clearly that elections have consequences. And I think that we should look at what people are saying and what they're doing when they're run, and what their history is when they're running for office.
Absolutely.
Because we have to have somebody who can act quickly and decisively to in an emergency. Who that person is and what their thoughts are and how they're going to act, it's too late to look at it once the emergency is there and they've declared an emergency.
But should a governor be able to take away constitutional rights from the American people and cite a virus as the reason?
Well, I don't think constitutional rights should be taken away or should ever be allowed to be taken away. There has to be the power concentrated in somebody who can make or some group that can make decisive decisions. And so this is the first time, at least in my lifetime, we've been faced with something like this. And we find out that, wow, it does give the governor or say a president the right to do those things, not necessarily take away constitutional rights. I don't think that should ever happen, that they can take away the constitutional rights, but to act swiftly, to mobilize and to put measures in place to help protect the people. That you can do that without taking away constitutional rights.
Absolutely.
If we look at what's happening, not only in our state, but around the country, that the constitutional rights have been sacrificed in many, many instances and have been attempted to be sacrificed in many instances.
I mean, and that's what we were all raised to believe in. We were raised to believe in that the people at the top were going to do what they possibly could. I understand there's difficulties in legislation. I understand there's always, deliberation. You got to talk back and forth and you got to try to make people see your perspective. But I just don't believe that we should be able to take away the whole founding principles of this country. That's what makes this country so great. You know what I mean? I've been to many countries around the world. I've been to China multiple times. It's a whole different environment over there. You speak up, you'll get shot and they won't care a thing about it. I don't, I think we definitely need to look back after this is all done and said, what is acceptable and what's not acceptable. So I guess my last thing before I keep you all day, because I could just talk, I don't want to do that, is, so I don't know if you know much about my background. I'm a professional fighter. I fought all over the world. I fought in Brazil. I train athletes. I've been to almost every country that has big sporting events. I have people in the UFC. If you watch television on Fox Sports or ESPN, I've walked people out to the ring. So my career, I have a 14,000 square foot facility in Brighton, Michigan, where I work with the Livingston County juvenile courts. I train children. I do free self-defense for the community. I work with women. I work with professional fighters. I work with everybody, people just for fitness. I've dedicated my life from when I initially started this dream to building this thing. And now in a new normal, how do you do jujitsu or wrestling without in this new norm? How do I train martial arts with people and interact in that environment when you have people terrified of a virus that, you know, although the media initially reported it's, you know, going to kill 3% of the people to get it up to 10%. Time will show that is incredibly far from reality. But now we still have people saying, hey, we need to keep social distancing. Doesn't matter that you're healthy. Doesn't matter that you're not in a hard hit county. Doesn't matter that you will not go around people that are high risk. I'm still following all the orders. How in the world can I possibly run my business that I've dedicated a decade of my life? How do I do jujitsu? How do I wrestle with partners and have people wrestling? How does that happen in this new world?
Well, I obviously think that anybody who can maintain a safe environment and some of the things that you mentioned, such as making sure that high-risk people aren't there, making sure that positive people aren't there, making sure that you're only dealing with the healthy people, that the facility is sanitized as it...
But what about an asymptomatic case? Someone comes in, I don't know they have it?
There's always that possibility. And you know, that every time you go to the grocery store, if you go to the grocery store, every time you walk into any place. I happen to go to the post office because I have a post office box. I mean, that's...
So you understand. What you're saying is beautiful, and I need to use it in my argument moving forward. There's risk in life. Like, listen, like, there's risk in life. Pneumonia could kill you. The flu could kill... I mean, as much as we know about influenza, we have vaccines. We have decades of study. As you said, we've known about this forever. And yet in 2017, it killed 60,000 people. It might kill more than corona, a novel case that outbroke worldwide. You know what I mean? It might kill more. So yep. With that being said, I had these people saying, until we can test every person in America, we can't open back up because they're so afraid. Can you imagine if this upcoming flu season, I was to say, Hank, I don't believe that any of us should leave our homes until we've tested every American for influenza because 60,000 people died in 2017. We can't leave our homes. You need to protect us. There's a certain point where we've gone too far. We need to practice good procedure. And we need to get back to living because that, you know, there is risk in step in your car. You're taking a risk. How many people drink alcohol? I bet you it kills way more people than coronavirus. How many people smoke cigarettes? I bet you that kills way more people than coronavirus. We don't do anything to stop these risks. There's an opioid epidemic in this country. People can die left and right, but there's a lot of profit that hasn't got shut down. But yet, you know, I'm trying to have this discussion with people, and I'm very glad what you just said because it means a lot to me. Because people are going, oh, you just can't do that stuff anymore. And that's just not the answer. That's not the world. That's not freedom. That's not, you know, if you're at high risk, absolutely right. Do not go into a jiu-jitsu academy. Don't go to a martial arts school until we know everything about this virus. If it's proven that, hey, asymptomatic, we're through the roof. Guys, this virus is a 0.02%. You're going to be okay. Fine. But we can't you can't just say tough luck, James, everything that you have is destroyed. What you said means a lot to me because I haven't found anyone that was willing to answer that honestly. There's risk in life. There's certain risk. I can do everything I can. I can put up sanitation. I can beg people, if you have any symptoms, if you feel any certain way, please stay home. If you're over 50 for this period of time, I'm not going to let you come in and train. And I apologize, but it's just for your own safety, right? But at a certain point, we can't get so caught up in fear that we abandon reason. You would agree?
Absolutely. And I think that, you know, you some of the things that you named that cause more deaths that we do to ourselves, alcohol, drugs, and going along kind of with what you do, Obesity is now the biggest cause of in this country, and that's self-inflicted for the most part. I shouldn't go on record saying that, but
no, everyone would understand what you're saying. They are self-inflicted things.
Yes, and there is some. We will never, ever, ever eliminate the total risk. I mean, this virus. Do we know what happens if it's frozen? I mean, how many bags of ice cubes maybe somebody made that, and maybe this virus survives if it's frozen. Who knows? There will always be some risk, but I think if we go into it with our eyes open as to what the risk might be and mitigate as much risk as we can, taking away a person's livelihood, and that's essentially what has happened. And I can see the initial shutdown.
Shutdown when we didn't know.
No, we didn't. I think now, and we do kind of need more. I would like to see more data, but I don't think that we're going to get the data.
Sure. Data comes a year down the road when we can look at all the final numbers. We can study antibodies. So at a certain point, there's a risk versus how many millions of people do you damage in light of, well, we'd like to see the data. You know, you've got to look at trends. You've got to look at current studies. You've got to take everything into account and say, hey, if you are still terrified, if you are high risk, if you are still worried, you can still quarantine. You do not need to go out. But at a certain point, we cannot destroy millions of lives, put people in. Poverty kills people. Poverty kills people, for sure.
Oh, absolutely. And I think
suicide rates can kill people. I mean, how many people die from suicide? All these things need to be taken into account. And everybody's narrative has been focused just on the virus. And there's such a bigger picture in front of us.
Yeah, I agree. I think that we will not have the data that we need in front of us in time to eliminate all types of risk that would ever happen. The data will be good, but it'll be analyzed in retrospect, I think, instead of being the thing that's going to absolutely dictate what we do. But I think businesses that are maintaining safe standards, and actually the CDC has some good ones. Some of the businesses, such as yours, I don't think could ever meet of the CDC.
Every guideline I've read, I can't possibly meet them. It's not possible, but I can do my absolute best.
Yes, if you're working with people, being careful about the high risk people or people that may have been exposed or people that have symptoms coming
in. Of course.
But people using good sense, I think that we have to start loosening up, getting. I just know too many people who have really lost. Who have really lost their family businesses that have been in the family for years, businesses that they've worked to develop.
100%.
They're laying off employees, which is one of the hardest things to do. I knew I had my own business, and you look out for your employees. And it's a tough thing, but I think that we can take a rational look at it and start opening things up again.
Well, man, I can't tell you how much I appreciate your time today. I don't want to keep any longer. I don't even know how long we've spoke for, but it was a true pleasure.
It's been nice talking to you, and I hope that we can get something done. We have presented a plan to the governor, or a guideline to the governor. We do have a plan the legislature does to start getting things going, to look at regional areas. Here in Livingston, we've had now 11 deaths, I believe.
Yes.
And of those 11 deaths, I forget what the percentage is that is above 70 years old. And I know that at least 10 of them had pre-existing conditions. And that's still a lot of people to die, and it's horrible. But I think shutting down the entire state because of things like that is probably not the best thing to do.
Well, you know what? You're the one fighting the good fight then, and I'm just sitting here hoping. So just try to think about people in a situation that, like, because my window is a little bit outside of the norm. You know what I mean? People may not have even considered like martial arts and things like that, where businesses that, you know, like I consider myself a huge part of the community. I work with tons of local police and the court and many people, and I donate my time and I speak at the schools, And if I can't open by June 1st, I will lose everything I've had. I'm already struggling to a level that I never thought I would struggle when I built a very successful business. And it's like, I will follow every guideline possible. I will say, okay, a certain amount of high risk can't come in. I will say any symptoms and, you know, but there's risk in everything. Like you said, if you haven't taken care of your health for 40 or 50 years, you're badly obese by self-infliction. You drank alcohol horribly. You smoked. You're at high risk, not for just Corona. You're at high risk for everything. Like, you're likely to die of everything. Heart disease, you don't even want to look at those numbers. So now I just don't know if I feel like millions of Americans should lose everything they've built because of certain specific hotspots and certain specific high risk, as you said. So just keep fighting for us, Hank. And like I said, it really means a lot to me today that you're willing to come on and just talk about this, because this will be something that's studied. This will be something that we'll look back at, and policy changes may be enacted. And hopefully as a society, we just get better.
Yeah. Well, let's hope so. And we will work at trying to make that happen. So
awesome. Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate it. And you have a great day.
Thank you. You also. Thanks.
All right. Take
Bye.
Care.
Bye.